looking for? Was that all it was? Okay. Welcome to FBC Live Midweek. It's Wednesday again, or Thursday, depending upon when you get to watch this rebroadcast or live stream, either way. I just want to say once again, I'm so appreciative of you being able to join with me today. It's kind of a rainy day outside. We're all the way in the month of May, and I am just grateful that we've had these few weeks together to look at how to read your Bible. And I'd like to, this morning, remind you, of course, of the other opportunities that you have on FBC Midweek. We have Tuesdays, of course, at noon that we broadcast Tuesday evening, and then this Wednesday we broadcast on Wednesday evening as well as Thursday morning, an opportunity to for you just to have that midweek opportunity to gather together. Although you're in your own home, you're gathering together in spirit with those that are around, not just this valley, but spread across our state. And I'd like to thank you for the privilege of being here. I'd like to tell you that if there's any way that we can minister to you, you can always go to FBC Medford website and contact the church office. We'd love to be able to just reach out and have that little bit of a personal contact with you that unfortunately the television and the camera doesn't allow us to have. If you have been with us for the previous weeks, you know that this series, this How to Read Your Bible series, has kind of been a little bit like Gilligan's Island. You might have thought you signed on for a three-hour tour, but it's taken a little bit longer. This six-week session is now already in our seventh, eighth week. Who's counting, right? But I did want to just give you a little bit of a lay of the land of where we're going to be going. If you have received your study guide already, you know that the study was divided up into six sessions. Well, clearly we've gone past 6 weeks, and today we're going to be on page 23. We're going to be on session three of this 6 week study. So I just wanted to tell you what to expect. Today, the objective is, and clearly I need to remind you that if you're not listening fast enough, we could be, 10 years on this. So I'm encouraging you today, we need to listen quickly. But more importantly, I just want you to know the plan today is to finish up session three in your handbook, which starts on page 23 and goes through page 25. And then next week, we'll go into session four, and we'll probably be there for 2 weeks as we look at the New Testament. Today, we're going to wrap up the Old Testament, and next week, we'll look at the New Testament. And of course, the objective of these two sessions, which are more weeks for us, is just for us to begin to get the big story that God has recorded for us in the scripture. We spent the first several weeks talking about the importance of the little stories that make up the big story. But we've also been reminded, hopefully, more than once, that it's important as we read the small stories that we understand the big story, because it's in the big story that we begin to see God's faithfulness. We see his hand of provision and protection. And the amazing thing about the scripture, we have the privilege this side of the cross that we have both the Old Testament and the New Testament, which gives us the story of how God worked before Christ was born. And then we also have the story of Jesus Christ, of his first advent, how he came to be born as a baby. He lived sinlessly so that he could die as our substitute. And the amazing thing for you and I, the privilege that we have, not only with a plethora of Bibles available to us, but we also have the privilege of hopefully having already come to that acknowledgement of our need for Jesus as Savior. We have exchanged our sinfulness for his righteousness. And in that process, we have entered into not only salvation, but an ongoing eternal relationship with Holy God, who sent his son to die for us, to pay for that sin debt. And in that exchange of my sinfulness for his righteousness, in that moment of salvation, we know that God graciously has allowed the Holy Spirit to now come in and indwell believers. And so we on this side of the cross not only have the privilege of knowing our Savior, knowing his name and knowing the fullness of the promises, still waiting for him to come back again. That's where we're going to end up today. But I want us to really recognize that the privilege is not just that we have entered into a relationship with him, but he has also given us the additional privilege of having the fullness of scripture. We have both the Old and the New Testament, and it's through the big story how we can, because of what Christ has done, because we know his first advent, we know who he was and what he's done on our behalf, we now look to the Old Testament through the prism of the cross. And that's getting the opportunity of getting the lay of the land, the big picture that helps us to better understand the small pictures. So in these next few weeks, and the plan is that by the end of May, we will have wrapped up this series on how to read your Bible. We will only get through session four, however. I don't anticipate that we'll have time to do the last two sessions in your handbook. But it remains to be seen how quickly you listen and how fast we can get through it. But at the rate I'm going, this three-hour tour is going to turn into about a 10-week session. So are you ready to get started with a word of prayer? And we will dive right into the scripture. Father, thank you so much. Thank you for your faithfulness to each one of us individually, that you so loved us that you sent your son to die for us, that your spirit continued to draw us to yourself to the day that we understood how much we needed Jesus Christ to be Savior of our lives. I thank you that even today, your Spirit is indwelling us and your Spirit is our teacher. We ask that he would be present today, both here on this stage with me and in the homes of people who are watching, that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher and would help us to understand the big picture so that we can better understand the infinite God who loved us and planned for our salvation. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. So if you were with us last week, you know that we did a quick overview of both the beginning of Genesis through Joshua last week. We kind of ran out of time because you weren't listening fast enough. See, it's a pattern I'm beginning to detect with you. So get on board. Today, I'd like for us to just to step back just a little bit. Again, for those of you who have been with me in the past, you know that I do not hesitate one bit to step back a little bit and to pick up maybe some things that I might have just flown over a little bit too quickly last week, things that I think are really important for us as you are reading the small stories, because the books that we look at from Genesis to Deuteronomy, those books of the Pentateuch are so essential to understanding the full arc, the full spectrum of God's redemptive plan that he set in place all the way at the garden. And for us to really grapple with and not only intellectually understand what God has been doing in the course of history from the time of creation until even today, we must understand that what God did in the Pentateuch, in these first five books of the Bible, was really lay the foundation for everything he's going to do all the way through, up until even the day when he comes back the second time. And so it behooves us, especially as believers in the 21st century who have perhaps, most of us grown up in church, been very familiar with Bible stories, it behooves us to understand that God was intimately and precisely working through each generation from the time of Adam and Eve all the way to our generation. He's never stopped working each generation individually to draw us as individuals into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'd like to just remind you of the passages we read last week, both in Peter and in Romans, as we talked about how important it is for us to understand that God is patient. God is not slow, as the world will say he is, or as men say he is. He's not slow to fulfill his promises, but he's patient because his will is that none would perish, but all would come to repentance. So as I said last week, every day that we wake up and Jesus hasn't come back again yet is another day for people to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, for others to enter into this privileged relationship of salvation. And so as we look to the Pentateuch, as we look from Genesis to Deuteronomy, it is not a waste of time for us to stop to just kind of immerse ourselves into the fullness of the story of how God was preparing his fallen creation to receive him. One of the things that we talked about last week was the promised seed, how important it was for us as believers to begin to look back through the prism, as I said, of the cross, and look back to the beginnings of history and see how God was actively and intimately involved from the very beginning to not only prepare mankind for a coming Redeemer, but also to help mankind recognize his need for a Redeemer. Because one of the first steps in the salvation experience, regardless of what generation you were born into, is your absolute the necessity of knowing that you can't do it on your own, that you are dependent upon a substitute who will step in and do for you what you cannot do, pay your sin debt so that you can be restored back to wholeness in relationship with Jesus Christ. Just for free, this is not in the notes, but one of the admonitions that is continually repeated, especially starting in Leviticus and moving forward, is that we are called to be holy as God is holy. And one of my most favorite definitions of understanding what holiness is, and there's lots of ways that you can talk about it being separated on, you know, separated away from and onto God himself. But one of the best ways for me is to understand that holy, H-O-L-Y, is really best defined as whole, W-H-O-L-E. We are without God in our sin. But when we come to Christ as a Savior, he comes in and he completes us. And we become holy. We become whole, W-H-O-L-E. And therefore, God can look at us as holy, H-O-L-Y. All of that was just to throw it in for you, that the importance of understanding the coming seed, the promised seed, is that without him, without this substitute sacrifice that God promised for us, we would be left with gaping holes, not only physically, spiritually, and emotionally. And when we meet Jesus, he fills that, and we become complete. We become whole, holy in his sight. And so last week we had the privilege of being challenged to continue to look for that promised seed. It started in the garden with Eve when God promised that he would send one who would defeat the enemy and in the process have his heel bruised. But today I'd like to just throw in one more little facet for you to be looking for as you track this promised seed, starting in Genesis, going through Deuteronomy, and then going into the rest of the Old Testament, is that what we will see is God's promise. In fact, if we had time, I'm not going to take it. It's very hard for me not to. But we're not going to take time to go into Genesis chapter 3. But I want you to see that that promise of the seed was that Eve would have someone who would come through her as a seed that would defeat the enemy. That promise was made not to Eve, not to Adam, but in fact was made to the serpent himself. And so it's not surprising that the enemy of our soul, the serpent, Satan himself, has been on a quest from the moment in the garden to stamp out the seed, to annihilate and eliminate, at best thwart, the plan of God's redemptive provision, which is the promised seed. So we watch the promised seed as God, we talked about it last week, as God works through barrenness even in the people he's called, so that they recognize their need for dependence upon him, that this coming Redeemer is going to come because God is the one who's both providing and protecting. But we need to also understand that there is a spiritual battle going on that wants to annihilate this seed. And you will see that as a repeated theme throughout Scripture. In fact, I challenge you, as you're reading in the Old Testament, to stop and be alert for those threats that come in, whether it's to the nation of Israel as a whole or to particular individuals within the nation of Israel, that the enemy is out to thwart, to sidetrack, and if he can, to completely override the very promise of the seed. So it's important to know that starting all the way in Genesis, there is this ongoing combat going on between God's redemptive plan and Satan's pursuit to steal, to kill, and to destroy that which God has declared to be good, and then which God is in the process of redeeming back to himself. So we're going to look for the promised seed, both as God provides it, and then also as he protects it from the enemy that wants to do nothing more than to come and to wipe it out, so that there will not be a cross on a hill called Calvary. And the glorious privilege that we have, the perspective that we have in the 21st century, is we know that Satan was defeated. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more today. But I also want us to see, through this promised seed, we're going to see, specifically through Genesis to Deuteronomy, we're going to see how God directs the nation of Israel to put them in the position where they can be the blessing to the world that God promises through Abraham. So we're going to track from Abraham the man to his family, and then to the nation of Israel. And then before this hour is over, we're going to see how God then narrows that promised seed back down to a family. And it is just, what I want you to do is I just want you to step into the place of just rejoicing in seeing how not only omniscient our God is, how he foreknows things that you and I have no, even when we have the advantage of looking hindsight and looking back and we don't understand it. God understood it all from the beginning. He had a plan from the beginning. We also need to be able to just stand in the place of awe and appreciation that God has chosen to work through flawed people like ourselves. That's what we're going to see today. All the way through, that God makes a promise and he stands by that promise. In fact, the scripture tells us that even if man is faithless, which we are, unfaithful, God remains faithful. And you can see that through from Genesis to Deuteronomy in such a way that it really is a launching pad to take you into the rest of the story of the Old Testament of man's continued failure to be able to live up to that status of holiness until we meet the one who comes, who himself is holy, and therefore in his righteousness, in his perfection, in his holiness, I can stand and receive his righteousness imputed to me, because in his love for you and for me, he willingly took on our sin so that he could pay the debt in full. So what we want to look at as well through both Genesis and Deuteronomy, and of course this doesn't stop in Deuteronomy, but Deuteronomy sets the table for us so that we can sit down in the rest of the books of the Old Testament and begin to really feast on the provision that God gives to us, his intimate heart that wants to bring us into a relationship that is beyond our understanding, beyond more than we can imagine or think. And God is in the process of doing it generation by generation, with each generation filled with individuals, all of whom God loves. And so in with the promised seed and the family, there are lists, and sometimes you can think tedious lists of genealogies that as you're reading through the scripture, don't get bogged down with them. If you need to just scan it if you want to and move on to get the story until you begin to be more familiar with the big story and the little stories. But don't think that those genealogies are just there to take up space. One of the things that has always impacted me as I study the scripture, as I read and begin to get a bigger and bigger picture of who our God is in his infinite character, in his omniscient character, he has given us really just a few pages with words on them when we look at them in totality that helps us to understand the fullness of the character of who our God is, that takes us from time and space into eternity with him. And yet, it's only in these few pages that even the history of man can't be contained in that little thing, much less the story of our great big God. And so when we look at Scripture, we need to know that he is a great economist as well as a magnificent creator, Almighty God. And so he is not wasting space or ink by giving us lists of genealogies. God has a purpose. He has a purpose for listing names that are hard for us to pronounce, much less know the man behind the name. So I want us to, as you're looking at genealogies, I want you to remember three things. One, God knows the man behind the name. He knows the man behind the name listed in Genesis, listed in Numbers and in Deuteronomy, and then again as the nation comes back after the dispersion, going through Nehemiah and Ezra, and you read those genealogies again, know that your God who spoke creation, who holds creation in his hands, knows you personally. He knows you by name. He loves the whole world, but he created you, and he has a plan to bring you into relationship. The genealogies are there to tell you God knows us by name. He knows who we are. He knows our every yesterday, and he knows our every tomorrow. Therefore, we can trust him with the today. So the first thing about genealogies, take it personally. Take it personally that your name is not just written on a book that 100 years from now people aren't going to be able to pronounce, but your God, who wrote that name knows every part about you, and he loves you enough to send his son to die for you. Number one, God knows the man behind the name. Number two, God is in the business of showing us how he is tracking for this promised seed who's coming. If the genealogies that are recorded in the Old Testament were only those genealogies for the line that God is preserving and protecting for the coming Redeemer, then we would say these genealogies are only to point us to Jesus. But there are genealogies for lots of families and nations that are not part of the family of God, which is why it's important for us to know that God knows us individually. But primarily of great importance is that God is tracking through the individuals, the family, then the nation, back to the family again, so that his line is preserved. So the promise made in the garden to Adam and Eve, the promise made to Abraham in the covenant, the promise made to David, and we're going to talk about those covenants today, that God takes personally the responsibility to fulfill that through the promised seed. So we get to see those two opportunities. God loves us personally. God is all about his redemptive plan, and nothing is going to stop him short of accomplishing that which he has set out to do. And then thirdly, the genealogies also point us to the importance of community. In our day and age, and especially in this time of isolation, we can forget that God has called us to community. He's called us individually into a relationship with him, and then he has intentionally placed us into a body of believers, a community of like-minded people, so that we can encourage one another and help to invest in each other, so that we can grow in our knowledge of Jesus Christ, not just intellectually, not just in our heart of hearts, but so that we begin to live out that which God has called us to do. So genealogies, God knows us. God is preparing the whole world to receive the one seed who will come, who has come already in the form of a baby in Bethlehem, and will yet come again as the redeeming king, as the King of Kings in his second advent. And then thirdly, to recognize God has called us personally into relationship with him, but he has not asked us to stay isolated. He has placed us in a body, first in a family, then in a spiritual family at the second birth. So don't miss the message behind the genealogies. And then the next thing that we're going to be looking for, especially in the Pentateuch, are the covenants that God makes with his people. Covenants are they're more than a contract. They're more than agreement. A covenant is, and we see it in scripture especially, that God, who is above everything, he's above his creation, and yet he chooses not just to make a promise that he's going to send a promised seed, but he continually comes back to his people and gives them additional promises, a continuing revelation of who this Redeemer is going to be. Every time you see mention of a covenant in scripture, you need to stop and catch your breath. You need to find out what it is that God is introducing for the first time about this one who's coming as the Redeemer. Each covenant is going to have inherent in it promises that help us better understand who the Redeemer is going to be. Covenants are a special times, and usually we find them after times of sometimes great barrenness in spiritual truths. That at the time of Noah, we can look at the covenant God made with Noah. After all of the devastation of the rebellion of all of creation, God stepped in, preserved Noah and his family, then made a covenant with them that said, I will never destroy creation again through water. And then repeated in essence the instructions he had given to Adam in the garden. So every time you see the word covenant, I want you to stop a minute, catch your breath, look at where you've just been, and look at what God is saying. Because from that point forward, God is going to be working in a new dimension, in a new way with his people. And it's very important for us on this side to recognize every covenant, every promise God has made in the Old Testament is, according to the book of Hebrews, yes and amen in Jesus. They're all pointing us to Jesus. So as you look at those progressive promises, at those covenants, that God really puts the responsibility on his shoulders, and he says, I will accomplish this. Now, we will see again this morning that with the Mosaic covenant, there's going to be a caveat of, as long as you are obedient, in the, then you will be, as long as you're faithful in the land, then I will bless you in the land. And we're going to see how that worked in the course of peoples. So the promised land is tied intrinsically to the promised seed, because Abraham's promise, God, when God made a covenant with Abraham, it was that God would bless him with many descendants, that he would have nations as descendants, but there would be a special blessing that would come through Abraham that would be a blessing to all the world. And in those covenants, there was the promise of the blessing to all the world. There was the promise of God's protection and provision for him. There was the promise of a land that they would possess. And both the promised seed and the promised land introduced to us in the Pentateuch, in the books Genesis to Deuteronomy, it's imperative that we understand that they're both pointing us to Jesus. What does Jesus promise us, and what are we still looking for from him? We know that he has promised to give us possession of the land. He has promised that we are going to enter into his rest and there serve him as King of Kings. And so in the Pentateuch, in this foundation, these foundational five books of the Old Testament, we see every root planted that are going to grow up into the tree, not only for the nation of Israel, but for the history of the whole world to come into this restored relationship with God the Father, who has called all of humanity into this place of needing a Savior, and he himself will provide them. But I want you to see the trek from Genesis to Deuteronomy. If we had time, I'd kind of walk you through each of the books, how they end. But let's just say that the end of Genesis, Joseph died and is buried in a tomb in Egypt. In the end of Deuteronomy, Moses dies. Moses died because, although he was a great deliverer out of Egypt, through this man Moses, God demonstrated to not just Egypt, not just Israel, but to all the world for all time, that God is supreme. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the living God, has supremacy over Pharaoh. He has supremacy over all of the gods of Egypt. And so God raised up a man named Moses to be the deliverer of his people out of Egypt into the promised land, to bring them to the promised land. And on the way was a mountain called Mount Sinai. And at that mountain, man had the privilege of hearing from God that God was having a covenant of relationship with him that would provide for them atonement for their sin. The garden had man's falling away from God, broken relationship. At Mount Sinai, we see the promise that God makes, not just to a nation, but to a world who needs to know that their sin can be atoned for. And God provides a picture of the Christ who's yet to come, whose blood will be sufficient. But in the meantime, the blood of animals will be the substitutes for that. So that, we can't miss the so that, the atonement was made available at Mount Sinai so that God himself could dwell in the midst of his people. The Ark of the Covenant is that picture. God, who was man, who was separated from God because of our sinfulness, God in his covenant loving kindness relationship steps in and provides a means through the covenant whereby God can dwell in the midst of his people. So Deuteronomy ends, this one who was the deliverer out of Egypt dies. The prophet who led them to Mount Sinai dies, because we're still waiting for a better prophet and a better deliverer as Deuteronomy ends. And then we go into the books of Joshua and Judges. And we touched on these briefly last week, so let me just kind of capsulize those for you a little bit. Joshua is God's gift, if you will. When Moses dies, God gifts the nation of Israel with this man, Joshua, so that he can lead them in to the promised land, so that he can lead them in the battles, so that he can lead them to great victory as they do warfare with the inhabitants of Canaan. Joshua is used by God in amazing ways throughout the book of Joshua, as he is called upon not just to be the leader, the warrior leader for the nation of Israel, but he's also, and don't miss this picture because this carries over for us into the rest of the Bible, Joshua is called to lead them to victory against enemies in the promised land, but God also gives him the unique privilege to be the distributor of their inheritance. Joshua, as he takes them in to conquer the land, he's also given the great privilege of dividing up the land and assigning the promised land to the various tribes. Joshua is such a picture for us of the one coming who alone gives gifts to man, gives us a spiritual inheritance that cannot be measured by land grants, is measured only in eternity. And Joshua just gives us that picture of the one coming who's going to be not only the one who's going to take us into battle, but he's going to be the one upon whom the battle rests on his shoulders. And so Joshua begins the process of the nation going into the land. And then unfortunately, Joshua too dies. And we have an amazing summary in Judges chapter 3 that helps us to better understand not just the times of Joshua, but the times of the judges as well. Chapters 1 through 3 of Judges kind of is the bridge between Joshua's lifetime and what he accomplished as the warrior leader for the nation of Israel into the time of the judges. And this is what the summary statement is. It says, these, and it's referring to the nations that have just been referred to in the second chapter, these are the nations the Lord left to test all the Israelites who had not experienced any of the wars in Canaan. Verse 2 is the one I want you to really grasp. God did this only to teach warfare to the descendants of the Israelites who had not had previous battle experience. We talked a little bit last week, in fact, that's why kind of where we ended up, was the battles that we read in the Old Testament, battles that can become wearisome unless we understand that God has designed each generation to go through battles of their own, not so that we can see an enemy or be fearful of the enemy, but rather like David facing Goliath, as big as the battle is, as big as the opponent is, if we can see our God bigger, we grow in our understanding of who our God is and how faithful he is. When we remember that God, in his infinite love for us, has strategically left us in battle zones so that we can gain a new appreciation for how big our God is, how dependable he is, how faithful he is, which leads us exactly to the time of Judges. As we have summarized in the time previous, and I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time with Judges except to say Judges is a series of times that is such a mirror for people of all times, of all nations, how we are pulled back to God in our times of need, and then as soon as things get easier for us, we can all of a sudden handle it on our own until we find ourselves once again at the bottom of the pit looking up, and God's the only one in our viewpoint. The book of Judges helps us to see that repeated cycle. But we need to remember that with every time we see man's failure, God steps in with his mercy. And the book of Judges is such a good picture of that, how God raises up individuals, some of them respectable, some of them you just say, how could God use him? The question is more appropriate, how does God use us? How does he? Except that he knows the person behind the name, and he loves us more than we can even begin to understand. The book of Judges points us to that. But the point of Judges, we've talked about this before, says the people need a king. The people need a king, because the people without a king do whatever they determine is right in their own heart. And rarely does that seek out the God who has the plan for their redemption. But tucked in to the time frame of the book of Judges, in the midst of God's people awry, God's people finding new ways to rebel against God's call to holiness, we have the story of Ruth. We have the story of a love story about a woman whose husband dies. She's a Moabitess. She marries into the family of Israel because the family has left Israel because of a famine. And there in Moab, Ruth marries an Israelite who passes away, dies, a descendant of Judah. And in that time frame, we are familiar with the story. We need to encapsulate it just real briefly and say that we see in the book of Ruth, we see the kinsman redeemer. We see a picture of a near close relative who steps into the place as Ruth follows her mother-in-law back to the town of Bethlehem, and there she meets her kinsman redeemer, the one who is a close relative to her, the one who steps in not out of duty but out of loving kindness, steps in and pays all of her debts so that she can come into a relationship debt free. And in that relationship, God not only honored Ruth, a Moabitess, one who would have been by birth hated by the Israelites, but one who was instead brought in and protected through the provision of the kinsman redeemer. Do you know that the book of Ruth has the term redeemer or redemption at least 20 times? The important message of the book of Ruth is not just a romantic love story. It is a cosmic prophetic view of what God is going to do through this promised seed that's coming, because it is through Ruth's line, through her relationship and marriage to Boaz, her kinsman redeemer, we have the line of Jesus. Her great grandson will be the king who will have a covenant made with him by God, David himself. And so in the book of Ruth, at the time of the judges, we see the sinfulness of man, and then we see the grace and the loving kindness of God being faithful to, of all things, a Moabitess woman. At a time when women were not held in high regard, a time when a woman would not have even had her name recorded legally on a document, we have her name recorded in the genealogies of Jesus. Oh, how precious are these little stories that help us to understand the big story. Because what we see from the time of the judges, we see a transition into the monarchy. And we see that happen in the book of Samuel, first Samuel specifically, and into 2 Samuel. Samuel and Eli serve as the transition judges from the time of the judges into the time of the monarchy. With Samuel, we see a man who was even promised. Remember, he's the son of Hannah, who was barren, and yet because of her heartfelt cry to Jehovah God, God heard her cry and sent her a son, whom she willingly offered back to God to serve in the temple with Eli. And Samuel grew to be the final judge in the nation of Israel. He lived to be the one who would anoint the kings. He lived to be the one who, when the nation asked for a king, his heart broke for them. And I just want to read again one more verse, and it's in Samuel. Helps us to understand the big picture that's repeated throughout Scripture, but specifically we see it in the Old Testament over and over again. Not so that we understand the brokenness of man so much, although we need to. What we really need to understand is the loving kindness and provision of our God. Israel has asked Samuel to give them a king. And Samuel, it tells us in I'm in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 6. The nation comes to Samuel and he says, "Give us a king to lead us." This displeased Samuel, so he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to the heart of your God. Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. What we see throughout the Old Testament and into our day-to-day is that regardless of how much God provides for his people, no matter how much he protects his people, no matter how much he gives to his people, man rejects God over and over again. And in Samuel, we see him saying, after God has told him, anoint the king, because it's not you they've rejected, it's me. Our human response, don't you think, any one of us making that kind of an assertion would be ready to exit stage left, right? You know what I meant. We exit stage left, you agree. But in the exiting stage left, that is not God's way. God's way that is, in spite of our rejection of him, he remains faithful. And so Samuel agrees to be the intercessor for his people. He says, it would be a sin, Samuel says, if I don't pray for you, in spite of the fact that you have sinned so grievously. And so with Samuel's anointing of kings, we go into the time of the monarchy. And the time of the monarchy is probably one of the more familiar passages of scripture for us. So I want to just encapsulate it just as briefly as we can to say it started with Saul. And it ends with Zedekiah. And in the middle of these kings, we have many stories. A story of the United Kingdom we've talked about, which went through David's son Solomon. Then we had the divided kingdom because of the civil war that took place between God's chosen people who were not pleased with one another or with the way God was working in their midst. Until finally, because they were unable to live obediently in the land, they are removed from the land. And so first the 10 tribes of the north, Israel, goes into captivity to Assyria, and they are assimilated into the nations of the world that are under the domain of the wicked and vicious nation of Assyria. And then we have just a single nation, just Judah alone. And even the 100 and some years that Judah survives on its own, we see again the repeated pattern of rejection of God. Although way back with King David, God had entered into a covenant with David personally and then with his family, that David would have a descendant. He would have an heir who would sit on the throne and reign forever. That he would have a son who, like David, would rule only better than David. He would rule not just the masses, but he would rule the hearts of the people. Because what we see in the book of Kings, we see a flawed monarchy. We see the repeated pattern of God giving and man rejecting. We see the picture of civil wars, both in the nation and in the hearts of people. But our God, who knows our plight better than we do, steps in and does for us what is unthinkable in our own economy. But in the promise that God makes to David, he provides for David a line, a family. So now we've gone from the nation of Israel, from the descendants of Judah, to now the line of David is going to be the one that is going to produce the one who's coming. Because David, too, dies and is put in a tomb. And so, to summarize real briefly, during the time of Judges, every man did what was right in his own heart. They needed a king. So God gave them a king. And what happened during those over 200 years of monarchy? The kings did what was right in their own hearts and led the people away time and time again. What man needs is a better prophet. What man needs is a better king. And we're still headed in that direction. So next week, clearly you weren't listening fast enough. I don't know what I'm going to do with you, but we're going to pick up at the exile next week. I want us to see how, when God promised his people that he would be not just their covenant maker, but their covenant keeper, he put a responsibility on mankind. He says, I will do for you, but you must respond to me. You must respond to the gift that I give to you. None of us would receive a gift and leave it unopened under the Christmas tree, take away the Christmas tree and leave the gift unwrapped for a year, a lifetime. God gives us the gift of a Redeemer, but it's our responsibility to personally accept that gift, to recognize our need for it, and then rip open that package and get to know the fullness of who our God is. The children of Israel were given the promised seed. They were given the promised land. They were provided prophets and priests and kings, but none of them were sufficient to change the heart. Only Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, can give us a new heart. And that's where we're going to go as we look at the exile, the prophets, and then the story of Esther next week. Thank you for joining with me, and we will see you next week. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for your grand story. Most of all, thank you for your grandson. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. See you next week.
my heart is breaking. You're my strength unfailing. You're my light unfailing.